What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. It's been a while since we updated this series, so I figured it's time to add to it a couple sorting algorithms, and today we are going to start with something easy yet very useful for academic purposes. In this video, we will explain, detail, and implement the bucket sort algorithm. Let's take this array as an example. Bucket sort is a sorting algorithm that divides the elements of our array into several groups called buckets. Each bucket holds inside it a certain range of numbers. Usually, the number of buckets is equal to the number of elements on our array. We'll see why in a bit. So, in this example, we can say that we have 10 buckets and that the range of each bucket is 10. So, the first one holds the numbers between 0 and 9, the second 10 and 19, and so on. After distributing our elements inside their corresponding bucket, each bucket is sorted individually using any sorting algorithm, or recursively by applying the same bucket sort algorithm. The process behind bucket sort can be understood as a scatter, sort, gather approach. Elements are first scattered into buckets, then the elements in each bucket are sorted, and finally the elements are gathered in order. Okay, now some of you may be thinking that here we are sorting integers which perfectly maps to indices, making it very easy to store and map the elements inside their corresponding list of bucket. But what if we were dealing with floating integers or strings? How can we use the bucket sort algorithm to sort this kind of data? Well, the point is to reach an integer. We want to map our input element to an index at the end. So take this array of floats for example. What we can do here, for example, is multiply the element we want to place in the bucket by 10 and take the floor value of the result we obtain. That's one way of mapping the floats we have to ints. After scattering our elements, we sort each bucket and then gather the items into the final sorted array. You see, it doesn't matter how you do it. The important thing to keep in mind is that the mapping function you choose should be uniform. So, regardless of how many times I apply it on an element, it should return the same result. Now, take this array of strings. One way to do it is to distribute the strings by their first letter into each bucket, then apply the same logic on each non-empty bucket by starting from the second letter, or simply stop here and sort the buckets we obtained using any other sorting algorithm. Yeah, I know this might not be the ideal solution to sort things. We previously did cover several better techniques to do that, but the point is, if you want to do it, you can, of course. Okay, before we dive in the implementation, I want to discuss complexity. Bucket sort shines if the elements you are trying to sort are uniformly distributed inside the buckets. That is why I mentioned that it is best to create a number of buckets equal to the number of elements we have. If each element sits in a separate bucket, or if the elements are distributed over several buckets, then this algorithm takes O of n time complexity. However, the worst case scenario occurs when all the elements are placed in a single bucket, meaning that all of our initial elements are very close to each other. If this happens, the overall performance would be dominated by the algorithm used to sort each bucket individually, so the worst case may vary from O of n squared to O of n log n time complexity. Okay, with that said, let's try to implement, together, the bucket sort algorithm. And we are going to start with the bucket sort class, which of course we tried to generalize as much as possible. I will talk about why we need the number class, comparable interface, and that by function parameter here in a bit, so bear with me. The first couple of things I did was retrieve the number of elements we have, as this will be the number of buckets we need to create, and I initialized my buckets, which I prefer to represent as a map. This will give us more flexibility if we were trying to sort different types of elements, as the index we previously talked about is now a key in our map. For this implementation, we are going to stick with integer keys and number values. Why? Well, because after initializing our buckets to empty linked lists, and after we fill our keys, what we need to do is map our elements to these keys. And in order to use the same function we made use of at the beginning of the video, which multiplies the element by the number of buckets in case we have floats, our elements must be numbers, or we won't be able to apply the multiplication on them. So, to do that, as you can see, I passed in a by function, and based on its result, our elements will be mapped. This function, which in case of floats multiplies the elements by the number of buckets, is passed as a parameter, allowing us to change it as we see fit and based on the input we want to sort. In this example, we passed in the list of floats you see, and based on the function provided, each element was mapped to its corresponding bucket. Now, after doing that, and as we previously saw, each bucket has to be sorted on its own. For this purpose, we made use of the collections.sort method, which behind the scenes makes use of the TimSort algorithm as written in the official Java documentation. But do not worry about it for now, as this algorithm will be covered in a future video. Okay, after doing that, the last step is to gather all our items into the same list and return them. This was done using the stream.flatmap.toList methods. Finally, to test our logic, you can simply run the code snippet you see in the main method in front of you, and the result will be as expected. If you want to run the bucket sort class we just implemented on some other type than floats, let's say integers, all you have to do is create the list and specify your new mapping function, and that's it. As you may have guessed, we cannot use the same function on integers, because if we divide all of them by 10, they will be mapped to the same bucket, and given our implementation, we won't even reach that stage, as a null pointer exception will be thrown at us, because the map we created will not be holding 100 keys, but only 10. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.